Amen.
Well, I was going to make a correction in front of my wife, but she left. She must be going to prepare lunch. I said we'd been married 45 years. We've known each other 45 years. We've been married 43 years. So I needed to make that correction. And I was going to do it in her presence. But last night I got home. We're driving two different cars, obviously. And I got home and she was already dead asleep. And so I crept into our bedroom and flipped off the lamp that she'd left on. She was sleeping in the light. And that woke her up and she was just in a dream. So she was wide awake. So we sat there for quite some time, and I began going through what I've been planning to do, get to at some point, and this is where we're at. And I started running down just between her and I all the characteristics that I'm familiar with that are associated with the Omega apostasy, and how what's going on now, I don't know of any of those characteristics that you can't demonstrate that are being fulfilled. Okay, there's been people that teach error and different foolishness that have come in through the years against or within this message, whatever. But there's never been one that possesses all these various characteristics of the Omega. You know, there's probably 15 of them that I can mention, and it would be mathematically impossible, I would think, for a group to be raised up that met all of these and not be the Omega apostasy. It's just, you know, and by the characteristics of the Omega apostasy, I'm talking about the ones that you're familiar with. Books of a new order, a new movement, a new organization. Nothing will be allowed to stand in the way of this new movement. They cannot reason from cause to effect. So I have enough things in place. I had to cover verses 13 through 15. I could have did that a little bit more thoroughly, but I have that in place. I've mentioned some things on issues that have come up just here at these meetings. But the reason that I have this here like this is I did this in a sermon last Sabbath, and there was a sister that's here that afterwards she came up and she says, I'm glad you did it this way because I wanted to see it broke down somehow like you just did, to where I could see the difference between what is being taught and what's truth. So the reason this is here, that I have Omega, this is just a waymark. Typically, it would just be a line. But it's fat, so I can put Omega in there. And by Omega, I mean the end, okay? Because on either side of the issue, whether how we're understanding it or how they're understanding it, we agree that at midnight, probation closes. Okay, so either side of the issue agrees with that. But the difference is the things that we see happening leading up to the close of probation, they're saying those things begin at the close of probation and go this way. Okay, so this is a point of reference, and for you and I in this room, when we come to midnight and our probation closes, that's the end for us. One way or the other, we're either eternally saved or eternally lost, right? So that's the end. So Omega, when she's talking about the Omega apostasy, it's even fitting that the waymark that is the focus of our difference is the waymark that is the end. It's the waymark that is the Omega, if you can see what I'm saying there. It's the very controversy. How do you see these prophetic characteristics leading to the close of probation, to the Omega? Or do you see these prophetic characteristics coming after the close of probation? Okay, so I'm contending that Satan does not want us to see the history that leads to the close of probation. And because of that, these ideas, these concepts that these men are presenting are designed to prevent us from recognizing the history that leads to the close of probation. So I'm going to try to go through these notes on this subject that I left off of a few presentations ago. And on page 13 is where I was last in these notes. And what I was saying is that, well, I didn't say this, but I'll add this. Matthew 16 and 17 is a prophetic narrative that illustrates our history to the very T. Yesterday, last night, we looked at Matthew 16, 18, where Jesus says, "Upon this rock will I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." This is a statement that lines up with the midnight cry, because at the midnight cry, you're at the church triumphant. At the midnight cry, you're at the first day of the fifth month. Ezra left Babylon on the first day of the first month, and he arrives in Jerusalem on the first day of the fifth month. The first day of the fifth month is the Exeter camp meeting. It's the midnight cry. Therefore, it's Jerusalem. And in Zechariah chapter 1, he says, "The Lord shall yet choose Jerusalem again." The choosing of Jerusalem, the final choosing of Jerusalem, is his choice of the church triumphant, and it's marked at the midnight cry. Okay, but because of fractals, we know that the priests that are going to be part of the midnight cry, they're already separated and prepared at midnight. And the full development of the church triumphant is at the Sunday law. But the midnight cry, that's the dividing line. That's Jerusalem in Bible prophecy. And where the story of Jerusalem includes, as much as anything else, that the first thing that gets done is that a foundation is laid in the history of Cyrus, the first decree. Cyrus is vacillating on his willingness to participate. So in Daniel 10, Michael, Christ, comes down out of heaven, marking the intercession of Christ into Cyrus's resistance to moving forward with building the temple. And Michael prevails, Cyrus moves forward, and in the history of Cyrus's decree, the foundation is built, there's laid. And if you remember, there was some people there in that story that had seen the original temple. And what do they do when the foundation is laid? They're weeping and lamenting. So there's always an indication in the story of the foundation about a resistance that is raised to the foundational work. But what gets us here? Okay, what gets us here? And what I mean by that is what's being taught now that we're identifying as the Omega Apostasy. It attacks everything that has been taught in this message from the very beginning. So if when I'm saying that Matthew 16 and 17 is present truth of this day and age, when Matthew 16 begins, I won't go there, but it starts with raising a question about the sign of Jonah, okay? So in the very beginning, it's about a sign. And in this counterfeit work that's going on, there is a misapplication of the signs in the scriptures. One of them is that the sign of Cyrus is a sign of deliverance. And that 9/11, the sign of Cyrus occurred, and that we were to immediately understand what that was and enter into a glorified experience. But because we did not respond correctly to the sign of Cyrus at 9/11, then the Lord's giving us a second chance to do so at midnight, when the sign of Cyrus is to be repeated. And there's only one reference that you can use to even make a case that Cyrus is a sign. And it's the wrong application for that sign on lots of levels. But my point here that I, in the notes on page 13, was this, that this waymark here, where the claim is being made that this was the sign of Cyrus that we did not recognize, and therefore the Lord has to repeat it over here, this particular waymark is always a progressive illustration. It's never a singular point in time waymark. It has a progression involved with it. Okay, the decree has to go out from Cyrus saying, you can go back to Jerusalem and rebuild, but it's got to go all the way across his empire for the Jews to see that decree. So too, when the mighty angel of Revelation 10 came down and put 1 foot upon the land and 1 foot upon the sea, then the first angel's message is carried to every mission station in the world. That did not happen overnight. Okay, this particular waymark, the characteristic of it is, it's something that is covering a period of time. It's the earth is lightened with his glory when this angel of Revelation 18 comes down, and there's no evidence and inspiration that this is like lighting the earth with a strike of lightning that is there and then gone. The evidence is that the earth gets lightened more and more. Okay, it's progressive. Okay, so first off, this foolishness about this, the sign of Cyrus is just that. It's foolishness. Okay, and so is the claim that's made about the sign of Jonah, but that's another story. But Matthew 16, it addresses that in our history, there's going to be a misrepresentation on what the signs are all about. It addresses other things. It takes us right to Caesarea Philippi, which takes you to Peneum. It takes you to the church triumphant, which is the midnight cry. We won't go there, but I needed to say something about the sign before we start, because if you're going to reject what we understand about this, you're rejecting everything. So on page 14 now, I want you to see something. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go through these notes rather quickly and try to point out some things that are obvious fulfillments of the prediction of the Alpha apostasy. But where it says the first angel, if you read early writings thoroughly, she's talking about the first angel of Revelation 14 that is to be followed by the second angel. She isn't speaking about the angel of Revelation 18 here. And it says this: Jesus commissioned a mighty angel to descend and warn the inhabitants of the earth to prepare for his second coming. As the angel left the presence of Jesus in heaven, an exceedingly bright and glorious light went before him. I was told that his mission was to lighten the earth with his glory and to warn man of the coming wrath of God. Brothers and sisters, in this movement, this was a passage that was often used to show that the first angel of the Millerite history is typifying the angel of Revelation 18, because she's speaking about the first angel here, and she says that his mission was to lighten the earth with his glory. And in Revelation 14, where you have the three angels' messages, that first angel, it doesn't say anything about him lightening the earth with his glory. That is the angel of Revelation 18. So what Sister White is teaching us here is that the first angel of Revelation 14 is typifying the angel of Revelation 18. You see that? Therefore, the Revelation 18 angel that came down at 9/11, it must possess the same characteristics as the first angel. So point one is that the first angel said, "Fear God and give him glory, for the hour..." I'm starting to a verse late. Let's go there. Make sure I got to put this in place about the everlasting gospel, and I don't want to paraphrase it incorrectly. Revelation 14. In verse 6, it says, "I saw another angel," and this is the first angel. And Sister White was told his mission was to lighten the earth with his glory. So he's typifying the angel of Revelation 18. "I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people." Now, brothers and sisters, the first angel is representing the everlasting gospel. If it's typifying the angel of Revelation 18, then when the angel of Revelation 18 arrives, the everlasting gospel arrives. Okay? You follow the logic? Now, you might argue against the definition that you can define from scriptures of what the everlasting gospel is, but to do so, you're going to have to argue against several passages in the spirit of prophecy in the Bible. The everlasting gospel, I know this is a human saying that I'm going to give, but it's backed on several witnesses. The everlasting gospel is the work of Christ in producing and thereafter demonstrating two classes of worshipers based upon the introduction of a three-step testing prophetic message. That's the everlasting gospel. And if that starts when this angel here comes down, and it does, this is the angel of Revelation 18 that has been typified by the first angel, and the first angel was to proclaim the everlasting gospel, and Sister White says in selected messages that the everlasting gospel proclaimed by this angel is the same gospel that was proclaimed in Genesis 3:15. Okay? And in Genesis 3:15, you have those two classes of worshipers, one that's the seed of Satan and one that's the seed of Christ. Look, it's this story. So in this history, you're going to find the everlasting gospel represented as a three-step testing prophetic message that produces and then demonstrates two classes of worshipers. So, point number one. Galatians chapter 1. And upon the testimony of two, a thing is established. Verse 8. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than ye have received, let him be accursed. Amen. We are claiming that the angel of Revelation 18 descended at 9/11. It was typified by the first angel's message, therefore the everlasting gospel, the process of Christ's work producing two classes of worshipers and then demonstrating them at the crisis at midnight, began at 9/11 to preach that the Lord held his hand over 9/11 and that what has been taught about 9/11 is error, and that the characteristics of 9/11 actually begin over here, is another gospel. And those that preach it upon the testimony of two are to be accursed. But did you notice in these verses that there is a doubling? It's not just two witnesses, it's a doubling. So it's placing this curse into the very history that we're dealing with, the history of midnight to the midnight cry. That is where the doubling is applied.
Verse 8 is confirmed in verses 9 and 11.
Yes, 9 and 11.
Read 11.
Okay, but I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which we preached of me is not after man. Okay, so that's close. I know you're shooting for 9/11, but yeah, it's all there anyway. Anyway, okay, it's a different gospel, all right? Okay, so we have on page 14, Jackie's not usually here with you. Okay, so she's gonna help restrain you. I can't do it on my own. We have here from Great Controversy 3:11 and 3:12 on page 14, we have four paragraphs about the everlasting gospel, making our point. But I want to drop down to the final paragraph to just pull one point out of there. It was not the scholarly theologians who had an understanding of this truth and engaged in its proclamation. Had these been faithful watchmen, diligently and prayerfully searching the scriptures, they would have known that the time of night, the prophecies would have opened to them the events about to take place. But they did not occupy this position, and the message was given by humbler men. Said Jesus, walk while you have the light, lest darkness come upon you. Those who turn away from the light which God has given, or who neglect to seek it when it's within their reach, are left in darkness. But the Savior declares, he that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Whoever is with singleness of purpose seeking to God's will, earnestly heeding the light already given, will receive greater light. To that soul, some star of heavenly radiance will be sent to guide him into all truth. We have to heed the light that was already given. Okay, and I started down this logic the other night, and the logic was this, that it became second nature to me when I speak about the reform lines, because you just can't understand how many times I repeated those presentations over and over again in prophecy schools. The first prophecy school we had in the United States was in 2004, and we only did it because we needed to get it recorded in English. But for the years prior to that, we've been all around the world teaching these very same things, and they were being translated into other message into other languages, so we hadn't done it in English. But my point is that I quit thinking about the fact that the emphasis is that we have to guard the waymarks. We have to guard the foundations. It's just automatic to me. Somebody starts tampering with the foundations, that's a warning flag right off the bat. Okay, something's wrong. start moving the waymark, something's wrong. Okay, now that's what's going. That's what's going on here. We suddenly have. Now you have. You can take the reform lines, brothers and sisters, and you can mark waymarks that are just absolutely airtight, established on tons of witnesses. The time of the end. Okay, tons of witnesses. Even the formalization of the message. There you got Moses at the burning bush. Okay, you got Miller. You got. Tons of witnesses, formalization of the message. You got tons of witnesses of the first message being empowered. For a long time, we didn't see midnight, but now midnight's established. The midnight cry is established. The Sunday law is established. Close of probation. Those are just major waymarks that are there airtight. Okay, but this teaching over here has created a new waymark. That has virtually no second witnesses. There's some minor inferences for second witnesses, but what you need to see or think about is what they're doing. They're going 1, 2, 3, and this one here, and then they go on to 7. They go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. They got 10 in here, but this one here, this is the cross for them. All right, but you're not going to find any reform lines that are going to justify such a waymark here. You might see some inferences. I can see some inferences. But brothers and sisters, what are they saying about this? They're saying this is the cross. This is the most major waymark of them all. Okay, this is where everything takes place for them. And yet, in the reform lines, it isn't there. It's just not there. And they're not making a minor inference about this. They're saying it's the cross, and they're saying this is everything. Well, brothers and sisters, if it's everything, we need 2 or 3 witnesses at least to establish it. Okay, so I'm wanting you to see that. There are waymarks on these reform lines that are set in concrete. And not only are they set in concrete, these waymarks, we've been warned, are going to come under attack, and that we have a responsibility to guard them. Okay. Particularly the foundations. So at 9/11, just some past history, and I can't remember for certainty everyone that came across these little pieces of light, but at 9/11, as I understand it, the first person that recognized that the third woe, or whatever we identify 9/11 as, was fulfilled, began at 9/11, was a brother out of London who I was working with at that time. And I, as soon as he told me I got it, I took it up. But I think a brother named Russell's the first person that caught on that 9/11 was the third woe. Okay, but from that, if you think that this is Islam coming back in history, as I said the other night, then you're forced to return to the old paths and grapple with Millerite understanding, because the Millerites have already identified Islam and Bible prophecy, the first woe, the second woe. Here's where the triple application of prophecy comes in, and you can nail what the third woe is with those characteristics. But now walk through this with me. Go to Jeremiah 6:16. I had a brother here the other day at these meetings. He came, and I heard him say it, but I never thought anything about it. And then today he came and says, I apologize for what I said to you yesterday. And I says, what did you say? And he says, I told you that you make me feel dumb. And it was a bigger conversation than that, so I never thought anything about it. And I told them, I only make you feel dumb because when I'm teaching this presentation over and over again, it's, over a couple months, every weekend I'm teaching the same sermon, and you walk into the sermon 2 months in, and by now it's just, I'm preaching this sermon without even thinking about it, because I've been doing it for 2 months, and you're sitting there in the pew, and you haven't heard it before, and you're thinking, wow, this guy's really smart. No, it's not because I'm really smart, it's because I've been doing it over and over, and I ain't so smart, but I can remember how the Lord walked us through this understanding, and it wasn't human. Okay, it wasn't human, and it wasn't on the wisdom of man, okay? Amen. We were forced to begin to study Islam. There was a brother that I know that I was working with at the time that before the collapse of the Soviet Union, he had some people that escaped out of the Soviet Union, and they moved right in his town up in Minnesota. So that they escaped. It wasn't illegal. They were illegal immigrants in the United States, but they were from Russia. Okay, But they were looking for a way to live because they were illegal immigrants seeking asylum here. They didn't have no money. So as he interacted with them, he said, well, I'll pay you if you want to, if you'll translate these Seventh-day Adventist Bible studies into Russian. Okay? So he did that, and then the Soviet Union collapsed, and he sent those Bible studies onto the General Conference to be used as they went in and did evangelism in the Soviet Union immediately after it collapsed. Of course, it didn't work, because when they said, yes, we'd love to do that, we're going to go into the Soviet Union now, but when they published them all and he looked at them, they'd cut everything out about the mark of the beast and the papacy. Everything, all the third angel's message, the warning against the papacy, had been removed by the General Conference, and he said, forget it. I'll publish it myself. And so the first Bible studies that went into Russia were taken in there by him. And he met some people in Ukraine that became a point of reference for him and made friends with him. They had been in the underground church in the Soviet Union during the bad times. And they began using those Bible studies, and he made friends with them. And there came a point in time where he worked an arrangement that we would go to the Ukraine and I would give a prophecy school on Daniel 11, 40 to 45 to the conference leadership in Ukraine and almost all the past Seventh-day Adventist pastors in Ukraine. And I did that. And he took me there, he introduced me to the people, and then he went down to Uzbekistan, where he had been supporting an Adventist missionary in Uzbekistan, which is an Islamic country. And while he was there driving around, he wanted some water, so the taxi cab driver took him to a well in town where they sell this water in a bottle. Of course, he didn't know what it was, but he was providentially led to ask this taxi cab driver, you know, what's it say on this bottle of water? And the bottle of water says, well, this water is specially blessed because it comes from the tomb of Daniel the prophet. What do you mean? Well, back in history, and I forget which conqueror it was, Genghis Khan or whatever in that time period, when he got to the point to where he conquered the place where Daniel the prophet had been buried, I think in Iran, maybe Iraq, but I think it's Iran. Not sure about that. That conqueror, because they reverenced Daniel the prophet so much, they dug up his body, they cut off his leg, and they brought it back to Uzbekistan, and they buried his leg in this tomb of Daniel. And there's a spring of water that comes up there. So this spring of water is considered by these Uzbekistanis to be extra special because Daniel the prophet is held in such high regard in the Muslim mind. Okay, so my point is that he didn't know that. He got woke up to that, and from that point on, he began thinking and understanding that the key to reach Islam is the books of Daniel and Revelation. Amen. Because everything that the Muslims hate is in Daniel and Revelation in a negative fashion. You know, the Muslims hate the Roman Catholic Church. They hate the great Satan, the United States, and all these powers in Daniel and Revelation are put in a negative light. So he's continued that study from that point on. But him and I had been working in a close working relationship up to that point. And I began studying Islam with him. And we began traveling across the United States to people that were experts on Islam. But our paths diverged. He's convinced that he has the key to evangelize the Muslim world. And I began looking at Islam and prophecy. And it was all in the same period of time. So it wasn't any great wisdom. The Lord's providence was opening these things up. You know, he was putting people in the right place in the right time to open this light up. I watched it happen. So when you get to the point where you realize that Islam is a subject of Bible prophecy, but you've never really studied it before, then you got to break out the books, and the place you go is to the pioneers and see what they had to say about it. And that's how the Lord led this movement back to the old paths. And once you get back to the old paths, you get to Jeremiah 6:16, which says, thus saith the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein, and you shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. Also I set watchmen over you, saying, hearken to the sound of the trumpet. But they said, we will not hearken. Okay, so now the Lord, after 9/11, he's leading us back to the old paths. And we come to understand that these are the old paths, and we need to know these old paths because we're now dealing with the third woe. And on these old paths, you got the first and second woe that defined the third woe. But it opens up something else. It opens up that if you walk in these old paths, you're going to find rest, okay? Which leads you then to Let's jump over to Isaiah 27. It leads you to line upon line, the methodology of the latter rain. Verse 9 says, whom shall you teach knowledge, and whom shall you make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to his people, to whom he said, this is the rest, wherewith you may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. In Jeremiah 6:16, when we go back to the old paths, we see, stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths and walk therein, ye shall find rest to your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. And the rest leads us to here, and it says, this line upon line, this is the rest, and this is the refreshing. But they would not hear. Okay, so you know it's a message. If they're refusing to hear it, this rest and refreshing, it's a message, but the rest and the refreshing, throughout the scriptures, it's the latter rain. Okay? So you're led to the understanding that when you come back to the old path, and the reason you're going back to the old path is because the third woe has arrived. But you got to understand what Islam is at 9/11. What's it mean that Islam arrives at 9/11? You go back to the old path, and you see that in the history of the second woe, that there are four angels that are loosed from the Euphrates at the beginning of a 391-year, 15-day time prophecy that are restrained on August 11th, 1840. And you know what? August 11th, 1840 is when the angel of Revelation 10 came down, which typifies the angel of Revelation 18. Therefore, you see that when the angel of Revelation 18 comes down, that you should probably expect to see a restraint placed upon Islam, because that's what took place when the angel of Revelation 10 come down. Okay, so you're suddenly looking for this restraint of Islam, and sure enough, you find that George Bush goes to the United Nations right after 9/11, and he and the United Nations put a restraint upon Islam, and you're suddenly seeing that Millerite history is being repeated to the very letter, and if you walk in this truth, you will find the rest and the refreshing, you will find the latter rain. Okay? This is the logic that the Lord was leading this movement to, and by the way, this movement over here, it says the former and the latter rain comes over here in this history, not here, not here. They've moved it, okay? So the Lord led us to understand these things, or he held his hand over, he created this error for us to promote for 16 years before he removed his hand. Okay, and see, the problem with that, the problem with making the claim that the Lord, and I've already given this problem, but you need to sink in. The problem with that is that in the Millerite history, the Lord held his hand over a singular mistake, the fullness of the year. And when he removed his hand, we read it to you in your presence. When he removed his hand from that mistake, they found the same evidence that had proved 1843, proved 1844. So it didn't destroy their message. It brought their message to perfection. And it was just one mistake. Okay, and what I'm saying is, when the Lord removed his hand from verse 10 of Daniel 11, and we seen that the king of the south, Russia, was still standing there and getting ready to carry out the surprise attack of Raphia, it didn't change our message at all. All it does is it provides two waymarks in the history of Daniel 11, verse 40, that are coming right from Daniel 11. And Sister White says, much of the history that's taken place in fulfillment of Daniel 11 will be repeated. So we had justification for looking at these things closely, and it didn't change our message at all. One mistake, one singular mistake that didn't change our message, but what it does, it puts an urgency and a seriousness into this message like you have never heard before. But if it's him holding his hand over this, brothers and sisters, the error was, the claim that we were supposed to go back to the old past is foolishness. The claim that the latter rain began at that time is foolishness. There's so many errors that he held his hand over. If that was the case, that everyone in this building needs to pack up their stuff and go home. Okay, plain and simple. Okay, so That's where we're at. But now that we're seeing the actual expression of their prophetic message, it looks so weak that you wonder,
Amen.
Could this really be the Omega? I mean, didn't we expect something? But I'm telling you what, it is the Omega, because the mathematical possibilities of what's going on with these guys actually addressing all the characteristics of the warning of the Omega, there's no way that it can't be. It is. Okay, so I'm going to try to walk through that. For instance, go to Isaiah 58, another place we got led to. And this is from Jeremiah 6:16. Cry aloud, spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression and the house of Jacob their sins. Okay? If we're to go back to the foundations, the old paths at 9-11, because of Jeremiah 6:16, then at 9-11, we're at Jeremiah 6:17 too. And this is where the trumpet's supposed to sound. And I have many quotes in here I know I won't get to about this trumpet being the Laodicean message. It's the message of Jones and Wagner. It's a message to tell God's people that the way they're living is going to cost them eternal salvation if they don't break out of the lifestyle that they're in right away. Okay, but these guys are teaching. Now I'm going to try to show you something. Sister White warned repeatedly in the Alpha Apostasy that the men that were leading out in this could not reason from cause to effect. So I want to show you something. I hope you can follow the logic, okay? The logic that they are presenting is that you cannot see the difference between the wise and the foolish, and they go a step further, and we read the quotes last night where Ellen White makes it clear, if you can't see the two groups, you're not wise. She said it, okay? But disregarding that, they make an argument that from 9-11 to midnight, you have the 12 disciples, because you have the number 12 in here. Everyone familiar with putting the number 12 in here? Okay, so when you get down here, one of those 12, Judas is going to fall away, and we're all familiar with that. But in terms of it being wrong to address any problems in the church, I'll say it that way, or in this movement, their argument is we can't do it because Jesus never rebuked Judas in this history. Judas is the symbol of the tares. Judas is a symbol of the wicked. And Jesus gave us an example that even though he was working with the wicked, he never said anything negative to him. But I know that we know that's not true. We know that Jesus rebuked Judas a little bit along the way. But we also have to admit that the testimony is that he did less rebuking with him than any of the others because he knew, okay? So we'll grant him that claim. Jesus never rebuked Judas, okay? But here's the thing. It's absolutely part of this message that what made those disciples the disciples is that they saw that Christ was the Christ, okay? So those 12 disciples are illustrating a group of people at the end of the world that see that Christ was the Christ. And Christ became the Christ at his baptism. He was Jesus until he was baptized. Then he became the Messiah. Then he became Christ. Do you follow what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay, and that's what Peter was honored for. This is why I put it in the record. Peter was honored because he was the first of the disciples to recognize that Jesus was the Messiah. He was the Christ. Okay, now this is an important point. I can tell it because we got a wasp and a dog trying to distract our attention, all right? What made the disciples is they believed that Jesus was the Messiah. This is telling you and I that what makes the priest of our history priest is that they understand that 9-11 is a fulfillment of prophecy. that at 9/11, the angel of Revelation 18 came down. Brothers and sisters, these men can't reason from cause to effect. Because if they're teaching that 9/11 was an error, then they have no prophetic justification for applying the disciples in the history of 9/11 to midnight, because 9/11 was an error. Therefore, to use an argument that Jesus never rebuked Judas to place into this history, they can't do it because they don't have the justification for putting the 12 disciples in this history, because they've thrown 9/11 in the trash can. And they have all kinds of faulty reasoning like this that shows they cannot reason from cause to effect. I'm putting that in place. That is one of the primary characteristics of the Alpha apostasy that typifies the Omega, the inability to reason from cause to effect. You can't use that argument about Judas if you think 9/11 wasn't a fulfillment of prophecy. Do you follow the logic there? Okay, so this is what we're dealing with. Okay, now, in page 15, time check, 15 minutes. I'm gonna jump ahead and maybe come back to page 15. I want to put one other thing in place here with the... There's several things I want to put in place. This isn't the one I'm going to, but I'm going to use this one. Page 22. Okay, I'm going to start. If I'm going to do this one, I got to do a little bit of... Go back to page 21. Great Controversy 611. Where it says 1848-1844. It's typically understood by them and by us that this is August 11th, 1840. This is October 22nd, 1844. Okay, so in Great Controversy 611, Sister White says, the angel who unites in the proclamation of the third angel's message is aligning the earth with the whole earth with his glory. One of these brethren... I don't know that I have time to get into this, but these guys are rejecting the midnight cry message. What I mean by that is these guys are rejecting the light that's coming out of Daniel 11, 1 through 39, because Daniel 11, 1 through 39 is our midnight cry message. It is the message that's bringing verses 40 to 45 to perfection. It's the message that swells until the door closes. And these guys are rejecting that. And the way that they're rejecting it is that they're claiming that the image of the beast and Sunday law test in the United States that precedes the image of the beast and the Sunday law test in the world is the focus of Bible prophecy. So when they approach the book of Daniel, they're applying it to the history and the domain of the United States. Whereas the last six verses of Daniel 11 are global. They're about the papacy conquering the entire world. So they can't see the global implications that are being illustrated in the first 39 verses. They're unwilling to see the global implications in the first 39 verses of Daniel 11 because they want to force it into the history of the United States. Okay, so they're blocking off from their understanding the midnight cry message because that's what this is for us, okay? So in Great Controversy 6:11, she's talking about the angel of Revelation 18, and she says, a work of worldwide extent and unwanted power is here foretold. The Advent movement of 1840 to 1844 was a glorious manifestation of the power of God. You follow me? And so the next paragraph, the work will be similar to that of the day of Pentecost. So she's placing this history into Pentecost. And what we apply there, brothers and sisters, you should all know it, is that at Pentecost, Christ went to heaven. Then he came back down after he was resurrected, right? Here he is coming down out of heaven. And then he breathed upon his disciples. And Sister White says the act of Christ breathing upon the disciples was as a few drops before the plentiful showers at Pentecost. This was Pentecost in that history. Okay, so you have in the Pentecostal history, you have a sprinkling that leads to the full outpouring. Okay, so that's what she's saying here. She's saying Revelation 18 is going to parallel 1840 to 1844. Then she's saying it's going to parallel the history of Pentecost. And then in the third paragraph, she says the great work of the gospel is not to close with less manifestation of the power of God than marked its opening. The prophecies which were fulfilled in the outpouring of the former reign at the opening of the gospel are again to be fulfilled in the latter reign at its close. Here are the times of refreshing. So from 1840 to 1844 are the times of the refreshing. Stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the old paths, and you will find rest for your souls. Okay, this is the rest and the refreshing, yet they would not hear. Okay, so this 1840 to 1844 is the refreshing. This is where the latter rain takes place, whereas they're saying it takes place over here. Okay, you getting my point? Okay, next paragraph. Many in of great measure failed to receive the former rain. They have not obtained all the benefits that God has thus provided for them. They expect that the lack will be supplied by the latter rain. When the richest abundance of grace shall be bestowed, they intend to open their hearts to receive it. Somehow that's what they're doing. They are making a terrible mistake. The work that God has begun in human heart in giving his light and knowledge must continue, be continually going forward. Every individual must realize his own necessity. The heart must be emptied of every defilement and cleansed for the indwelling of the Spirit. It was by confession and forsaking of sin, by earnest prayer and consecration of themselves to God, that the early disciples prepared for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. What were they doing here? They were repenting of sin, okay? They were putting their sins away. That the same work, only in greater degree, must be done now. Then the human agent had only to ask for the blessing and wait for the Lord to perfect the work concerning him. It is God who began the work at 9/11, and he will finish the work at midnight. It was God who began the work, and he will finish his work, making man complete in Jesus Christ, but there must be no neglect of the grace represented by the former rain. Only those who are living up to the light they have will receive greater light. Unless we are daily advancing in the exemplification of active Christian virtues, we shall not recognize the manifestations of the Holy Spirit in the latter rain. It may be falling on hearts all around us, but we shall not discern or receive it. The sprinkling time, it's falling on two classes. One class is receiving it, one isn't receiving it. The one that isn't receiving it isn't recognizing it. They're denying that it's even taking place. They're claiming it takes place over here. You follow me? Now, my point is this. You have the quote, the next quote from Spirit of Prophecy, where she says the act of Christ breathing on his disciples was as a few drops before the plentiful showers at the day of Pentecost. So the next quote is an eye-opener. It says, the class who do not feel grieved over their own spiritual declension nor mourn over the sins of others will be left without the seal of God. If I were to follow their counsel, I could not mourn over your sins, because if I recognized your sins, then I would be taking the place of Satan in Zechariah chapter 3, who was an accuser of the brethren. I've been told that more than once on this subject. To recognize tares is to become Satan in Zechariah chapter 3, the accuser of the brethren. If I can't recognize some failings in my brothers and sisters, how can I mourn over those sins? The class that isn't mourning over those sins is the one that doesn't receive the seal of God. That's how I read that. But that's not my point here. The Lord commissions his messengers, the men with the slaughtering weapons in their hands. And where's she taking this from? Ezekiel 9. And Ezekiel 9, brothers and sisters, it's repeating Ezekiel 8, okay? It's the sealing, and Sister White says the sealing of Ezekiel 9 is the same sealing as Revelation 7. Okay, go you after him through the city and smite. Next paragraph. Here we see that the church, the Lord's sanctuary, was the first to feel the stroke of the wrath of God. The ancient men, those to whom God had given great light and who had stood as guardians of the spiritual interests of the people, had betrayed their trust. They had taken the position that we need not look for miracles and the marked manifestation of God's power as in former days. Brothers and sisters, the marked manifestation of God's power as in former days is the manifestation of God's power in 1840 to 1844, or from the breathing of Christ upon the disciples until Pentecost. They're marked in God's word. They're marked in the spirit of prophecy. They are the marked manifestations of the power of God. And when you get to the end, there's going to be a group of men who have taken the positions that there is going to be no more miracles and there is going to be no marked manifestation of the power of God. And this is where the power of God is marked in the reform lines from 9/11 to midnight. And they're saying that the Lord held his hand over 9/11, and everything we understand about this is untrue. It gets fulfilled over here. They're taking the position that there will not be a manifestation of the power of God from 9/11 to midnight, where the everlasting gospel is accomplished among the priests. If you can see that. Notice now, remember, when you see these other fonts that I've derived this from Brother M's, one of his statements in a chat room. This is him, his claim. He's asking the Lord one of the most foolish questions I've ever heard. Please allow me to join the blotting out of sin with the Sunday law test that begins at midnight for the priest. He wants, as a priest, for his judgment to begin after probation closes. If you get the implications of that. But notice what Sister White says. I cannot express to you the intense desire of my soul that you should all seek the Lord most earnestly while he may be found. We are in the day of God's preparation. Let nothing be regarded as of sufficient worth to draw your minds from the work of preparing for the great day of judgment. Get ready. We have to be prepared before. Again, these parables teach that there is no probation after judgment. No probation after judgment. When the work of the gospel is completed at midnight, there immediately follows the separation between the good and evil, and the destiny of each class is forever fixed. After his destiny is fixed, then he wants to go into judgment and have the Lord blot his sins out. What are you doing, brethren, in the great day of preparation? Those who are uniting with the world are receiving the worldly mold and preparing for the mark of the beast. Those who are distrustful of self, who are humbling themselves before God and purifying their souls by obeying the truth, these are receiving the heavenly mold and preparing for the seal of God in their foreheads. When the decree goes forth and the stamp is impressed, their character will remain pure and spotless for eternity. We all understand that this is typifying the Sunday law. This is where the sealing takes place. This is where it's pressed. Not over here. This is the day of the Lord's preparation. As Seventh-day Adventists, we know the day of preparation comes before Sabbath. The Sunday law is the Sabbath test. Midnight is representing to the priest the Sunday law test. It's the Sabbath test. It's the seventh day. The day before it is the preparation day. Okay. And we're being taught to disregard the preparation day, that once the Sunday law gets here, then the judgment of the living begins. Wow. This has been repeated to me so many times. It is the day of God's preparation to prepare a people to stand in the day of the Lord. Now I'll close with this one. Review and Herald, August 18th, 1885. And you know what I'm convinced of, brothers and sisters? I had the privilege to recognize that this Omega thing was here. I had the privilege to see it first. Okay, if Brother Tabo remembers, he was there. I know he remembers that I was the first one that started bringing this up. when we saw what was going on. And the reason that I was the first one bringing it up is because the brother that was going to speak there, the very first quote that he presented in his presentation was the quote about the Alpha Apostasy, the paragraph about books of the New Order. So he introduced it, okay? He introduced it, and he made a wrong application on it, so my antennas went up. From that point on, I'm watching what's going on, and I'm thinking, wow. So it wasn't anything smart on my part. The Lord had to have the wrong side of the issue, introduce it, and say, this is what we're dealing with, if you can see it, okay? And I started watching for it from that point on, but it took a while to really put your finger on it. And then I started looking and I realized, well, and I hate to do this, but, you know, that's the story of the Alpha Apostasy. Sister White, who was, you know, in a leading position, she was the first to see it. But if you read closely, you know what her, it wasn't a complaint, but you know what her complaint was? She expected the other people to see it or that she was working with. Okay, so here we are going through this stuff, and I want to remind you, brothers and sisters, you should be recognizing this on your own. The reason that heresies are allowed to come in is to force God's people to study. This is the last heresy. It's telling us that probation's about to close. So what, for whatever reason that the Lord is taking us back and reminding us of the steps he led us through to get to this point in time, it's about time that everyone in this room wraps their mind around it, because like it or not, probation's about to close. So this quote says this, and I'm making the point now about the preparation day. The third angel's message must go over the land and awaken the people and call their attention to the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Another angel unites his voice with the third angel, and the earth is lightened with its glory. In this context, this third angel is Daniel 11, 40 to 45. And the angel that joins it at 9-11 is the second angel. Babylon has fallen. And it confirms and empowers the message of Daniel 11, 40 to 45, because it demonstrates that the Millerite history is repeating to the very letter. That just as the angel of Revelation 10 came down when Islam was restrained, the angel of Revelation 18 came down when Islam was restrained. And Millerite history is being repeated. The light increases and it shines out to all the nations of the earth. There's one of these brothers that's saying that the earth is lightened with his glory only refers to the United States. That's what I was talking about, how they're hiding from this message by applying it to the United States. They're saying that the angel of Revelation 18, when he lightens the earth with his glory, it's just in the United States. Boy, if that was true, we got to go in and cut a whole lot of passages of the spirit of prophecy out. The whole earth is lightened with his glory. And just because the United States is the earth beast, it doesn't give you justification for making that a fulfillment just in the United States. The light increases and it shines out to all the nations of the earth. It is to go forth as a light that burneth. It will be attended with great power until its golden beams have fallen upon every tongue, every people, and every nation upon the face of the whole earth. Let me ask you, what are you doing to prepare for this work? Are you building for eternity? You must remember that this angel represents the people that have this message to give to the world. Are you among that people? Do you really believe that this work in which we are engaged is truly the third angel's message? If so, then you understand that we have a mighty work to do and that we ought to be about it. We must sanctify ourselves by strict obedience to the truth, placing ourselves in a right relation to God and his work. As the truth goes forth, beginning at 9-11, as the truth goes forth, Satan intensifies his zeal to defeat its progress by presenting pleasing delusions. As we urge the truth, he urges his error. Oh, brother, you can't see the two classes until you get to midnight. Oh, really? It's craziness, brothers and sisters. This is what you have to see. This is the visual test. There's two visual tests. The image of the beast began on November 8th, 2016. This, December 2016.
He stirs up his agents, a view of the coming of the Lord, to go out and cry, lo, here is Christ, and lo, there is Christ. And here arises the superstition, and there arises that heresy. And tell me, what are we to do about it? I will tell you. We can become familiar with the Bible and read what saith the Lord. Not only the ministers, but all who love and fear God are to do the master's work. And that is to let the light that has been given you shine before all. She can't be saying that. No, she is saying that. Here are two companies. One of them is being bound in bundles to burn. The other is being bound by the cords of truth and love. Satan is binding his followers with the work of iniquity. Christ is binding together his people in love and faith and in keeping his commandments. And this work will increase more and more, and Satan will work to divide and separate God's people one from another. And while he is doing this kind of work, be careful that none of you be found helping him. We want to put away our cold-heartedness and let love, tender compassion, true courtesy, and the spirit of tenderness come into our midst. Amen. Here we are in the waiting time. Amen. We've understood that this is the tarrying time. We've understood that this is the first day of the first month, the tarrying time, the waiting time. And here she's defining the waiting time as the day of God's preparation. The day of God's preparation is the day that precedes the day of the Lord. Here's where we are. We're in the waiting time. There's two companies. In the day of God's preparation, here in this world, we are to fit up for these great trials that are soon coming upon us. And yet some of us act as though we had a whole millennium before us in which to accomplish the work. But says the text, watch and pray, for you know not when the time is. And what Christ says to his disciples, I say unto you, take heed, watch and pray, that when the master comes to reckon with his servants, you may receive from him the crown of life laid up for the overcomer and rejoice with him in his kingdom. Brothers and sisters, there's a group of people in this history that are going to deny the manifestation of the power of God. And when you deny 9/11, you are denying that very manifestation of the power of God. And that manifestation of the power of God is the everlasting gospel. And the everlasting gospel is the work of Christ in producing two classes of worshipers that will be demonstrated here. And to teach that this is where all these characteristics begin. It's the Omega, and there's more evidence to this. And when you look at what these guys are doing, you can show that they're not reasoning from cause to effect. Their arguments are destroyed by other positions that they take repeatedly. So we will take this back up in the next meeting. Shall we pray? And I assume we got a big group here, other than the people that are working in the kitchen, so I'm going to pray for the food as well. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these days of study. We thank you for the privilege of being here in this time of Earth's history when this great spiritual crisis is beginning to shake this message, this movement. We ask that you'd give us the wisdom and discernment to navigate this tremendous shaking in a way that not only we can be ultimately saved, but that we can glorify you and win others. And that we might have the ability to help some others get back upon the platform that they've got off in the past, because we know that this is one of the promises that you've provided for this time. We ask that as we break here and eat some physical food, that you would put your blessing upon that physical food and bless the hands that have prepared it for us, but that you would also remind us that this is the sacred Sabbath and that we should keep our conversations, our thoughts in agreement with that as we do partake of the physical food. And we thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.